Welcome. You're a big crowd. I'm not surprised. We do have our rock star tonight. Welcome to the Elkhurst Street Synagogue. My name is Roberta Brandis Grass. I am president of the Center for the Living City and founder of the project to restore this historic synagogue. Many of you have been here, but for some this may be your first visit. I hope it won't be your last. Started in the mid-1980s, the rebirth of this singular house of worship evolved slowly and steadily in the same way that Jane Jacobs taught us long ago how neighborhoods and whole cities rejuvenate over time through the efforts of many individuals. 20 years, 20,000 donors, and $20 million is approximately what it took to restore this landmark that was on the verge of loss. This has been the largest independent historic restoration in this city, not connected to a larger institution or a public body. Jane actually followed the progress of this project through the reports that I would bring her on my visits to Toronto over many years. And she loved that the preservation effort, now formally a museum and functioning synagogue, embraced its Chinatown neighbors. And if you have ever been to one of our egg rolls, egg cream, and empanada days, you know that it is the most original, fun, and fascinating block party. Author and activist extraordinaire, Jane Jacobs was a lifetime student of cities, an architecture writer for Architectural Forum, and author of 7 books about cities, plus one about the Constitution, which she wrote while she was taking courses at Columbia. Her most famous book, Death and Life of Great American Cities, changed the way the world views cities and helped us understand how the city is a fabric with all its parts, streets, parks, sidewalks, buildings, intricately connected and interdependent. To celebrate the centennial of Jacob's birth this year, the Center for the Living City organized this year-long series of lectures to revisit, explore, and honor her ideas. Tonight is the 11th of the series of lectures by notable writers, thinkers, and activists to honor and build on the legacy of Jane Jacobs and to renew a discussion about her ideas. 2 years before her death, the Center for the Living City was established with her enthusiastic approval and support by a small group of urbanists expressly to build on her legacy. We are now national and international, with board members from Boston, Charlotte, New York, Salt Lake City, Toronto, Chennai, India, and Curitiba, Brazil. In the 10 years since, we have sent a young architect as a Jane Jacobs Fellow to New Orleans to help low-income homeowners figure out how to rebuild their homes after Katrina. We created a post-Katrina exhibit at the Museum of the City of New York, helped local people all over the world lead Jane Jacobs walks to observe their own communities, published 3 books related to Jane's work, and have now established this lecture series. Now we have just embarked on 2 new innovative programs with great thanks to the Ford Foundation. The first is working with the Girl Scouts of America. Jane was a devoted Girl Scout. To expand nationwide a locally created Jane Jacobs Observe Butt Bash, where young girls learn about cities, identify the needs for improvement in their community, and engage with their neighbors to seek change. The second will be developing regional workshops for journalists, including editors, to stimulate increased local coverage of critical issues beyond the press release from City Hall and to improve coverage of essential elements of local change. And you should know that this lecture series has been so successful the center will continue it beyond the centennial year. The lectures are all free, but we depend on the generosity of supporters to help us build on Jane's legacy. If you are inclined, pick up a donation envelope on your way out or leave a contribution to the center in the donation basket on the table in the rear. This series is what our executive director, Stephen Goldsmith, calls a trip. This is not just a celebration of Jane's ideas. This is an invitation to all of you to use these reflections to create responses to new problems. Jane taught us how to observe, understand, and value the urban life around us. Now we have a responsibility to put our own observations to fruitful use. And here we are, in this glorious 1887 landmark, talking about Jane Jacobs, who famously said, "Old ideas can sometimes use new buildings. New ideas must use old buildings." Tonight, we are especially honored to have Janette and Sadik-Khan, former head of transportation under Mayor Michael Bloomberg, and currently with Bloomberg Associates as an advisor on transportation issues around the globe. Janette is fond of saying, if you change a street, you can change the world. First, I can say from my own experience of observing and writing about urban change around the world that this is a true statement. I have seen the same evidence she has, but more importantly, you all have seen this to be true right here in New York under her leadership. 400 miles of bike lanes, 60 pedestrian plazas, and a bike share program that keeps growing. But most importantly, through all her actions, she demonstrated that the healthiest route for the future of the city is to switch from the car first to the people first mentality. Her impact on the city was huge, which laughingly caused some people to call her the Robert Moses of her day. This, of course, is ridiculous because she embodied the Jane Jacobs philosophy of small interventions bring big change. So it is my particular pleasure to introduce Janette, and following her remarks, I will join her on the stage for a question and discussion period. Janette.
Celebrate Jane and for her incredible work in the world of preservation and urbanism. And I think her passion is reflected in the walls that surround us tonight and in numerous buildings that you and I walk around and see each and every day. And it's thanks to Roberta that we can celebrate and appreciate the incredible beauty that we have on the streets of New York City. So it is great to be here with all of you tonight to talk about street fight and street fights. And I want you to know that the title of my book didn't just come out of nowhere. It was part of an homage to the original urban revolutionary, Jane Jacobs, and a woman whose thoughts on life and death of cities were in some ways so succinct and so obvious that it was hard to believe that no one had actually put them into print. And her one-of-a-kind description of the ballet of the sidewalk changed the way that we saw our cities, changed the way we saw our streets. Finally, we had language to describe the value of human-scale streets, like those in the West Village, where she lived and where I live now. And she was reacting to the modernist movement of urban renewal that led to 50 years of towers in the park and endless urban highways that left no room for the people that are so central to her philosophy. Plans that had designs like these. Really hard to believe. First step, pedestrians are removed. Second step, cars invade. That literally was the intention. But with Jane leading the charge, New York City was able to finally fight back against the dead pirate Moses. She helped kick cars out of Washington Square Park and recapture its role as the beating cultural heart of Greenwich Village. And she prevented the construction of Lomax, which would have cut New York City off at its knees, bulldozing untold numbers of homes and businesses in Lower Manhattan, all in the name of speeding suburban drivers from New Jersey to Long Island. If this had happened, New York City as we know it may not have survived. So we will forever honor her legacy, not just Jane's tree planted in front of a Broome Street church she saved in the great fight against Lomax. One of my proudest moments as commissioner was when we put in the protected bike lane on Hudson Street that was past her former home. But the story of Jane isn't just a simple tale of good triumphing over evil. It has some shades of gray. And in the 60 years after their epic battle, the legacies of Robert Moses and Jane Jacobs turns out to be a little more complex. In an ironic way, it's because Moses paved over so many streets that we actually have the space to reclaim it and prioritize it for people and for transit and for bikes. And for all of the harm that Robert Moses did to neighborhoods all across the five boroughs, it will take a Moses-like effort to act quickly and decisively to reclaim our streets and adapt them for a new age. The persistent problem that we face isn't just over-planning, but paralysis by analysis, where we no longer believe that change is even possible. And some may believe that change itself is bad. On Jane's side, let's just say that claiming to carry her mantle are more protectionists than preservationists at times. And if you took a poll of folks like these who protested the installation of a protected bike lane in their neighborhood, most of them would probably say that they were big fans of what Jane fought for. They just didn't want it in their own backyard. And today, this argument is being applied to city bikes. When people say that bike share is something that threatens the historic neighborhood of New York City. And they focus only on the bikes and the stations on the left. And they somehow overlook the cars that litter every space in the city. In fact, this space that is given away to cars for free. Cars that are used maybe once or twice a day versus the bikes on the left that are used 7 or 8 times. What they're trying to preserve are parking spaces, not neighborhoods. And that's hardly worthy of the Jacobean mantle. So where do we go from here? How do we get there? We have to start by finding common ground. Yes, after parking spaces. Common ground. And if there's one thing that we can all agree on, it's that for the past 60 years, streets in New York don't work very well for anybody, whether you're a Moses motorist or a car-carrying Jane Jacobs fan. We tried building a way out of congestion, but we really just doubled down on a lot of false assumptions about how cities really work. And while we stopped building highways a generation ago, we really didn't do much to improve the reality of our streets until recently. But in the last 10 years, we've shown that it's not enough to say no to out-of-scale projects or big-box stores. We need to have an affirmative agenda that people can say yes to. Yes, that it is possible to reclaim, reimagine, and redesign our streets. It just awaits those who care, and for people in this audience, those who dare. The work in New York City stemmed from Plan YC, Mayor Mike Bloomberg's long-range sustainability plan that looked at how we were going to accommodate a million more people between now and 2030 and still improve the quality of life in our neighborhoods and business districts. And that had profound implications for how we used our streets. And we translated that vision into a new strategic plan for the agency that brought us closer to the city and the streets that we wanted to see. And by the end of the Bloomberg administration, New York City was a very different place. We created 400 miles of bike lanes, 60 plazas, 7 new rapid bus lines, launched the biggest bike share system in North America, and had the safest streets. But that's the short version. The slightly longer version is that every day was a fight, a street fight, to give people more choices for getting around. And we were fighting to change the culture of New York, to set it in a new direction. And we learned some lessons along the way. And the first lesson is that you can paint the city you want to see. And like any city, we had to start with the materials that we had on hand. Paint, brushes, rocks, stones. But you can accomplish a lot with the supplies you have on hand. And we wanted to show New Yorkers what was possible. This is Times Square in the 1950s, and this is Times Square in 2000, 60 years later. And you could see that not much had changed. And if you had been in business for 60 years, and you didn't change your major capital asset in 60 years, do you think you'd still be in business? So a few months after our appointment, we created the first pedestrian plaza in New York in Dubbo on Pearl Street. And we did it with paint and planters, just painted the curbs. And it didn't take years of planning, and it didn't take decades and millions of dollars to do. We just showed people what was possible in real time. And we turned the space from a place that people wanted to park to a place that people wanted to be. And we did these kinds of transformations all over. This is 9th Avenue and 14th Street, where the traffic pattern was a relic from another era. And we created Manhattan's first pedestrian plaza. Everybody came in. This place is used 3 a.m., 3 p.m., constantly used. In fact, it's actually hard to remember what it used to look like. Because once you adapt it, people adopt it. We did it in Madison Square, which used to have one of the largest crosswalks in the city. It was a football field. And a warren of streets, very dangerous, where Broadway 23rd and 5th Street, 5th Avenue met. And we coned it off with orange cones. And literally 2 hours after we coned it off, an art class came in to start sketching, you know, right there in the street. New Yorkers are so hungry for public space. And today, it is one of the most successful public spaces in the city. People choose to sit in the street, in the plaza, rather than in the fantastic park next door. And again, it didn't take a lot of money or time. It just took some imagination and using our materials in a new way. And after creating a showcase of what was possible on city streets, we took our toolkit to the crossroads of the world, Times Square. As many of you know, probably all of you know, Manhattan is on a grid, north, south, east, west. Broadway cuts through it on a diagonal, does great things, it creates these great squares. But it creates also these hotspots of congestion where you have three-way intersections where Broadway crosses instead of just two. And people try for decades to try to fix it. And they put in slip lanes and different traffic signals, nothing worked. And it's not a surprise because the street was out of balance. You had 90% of the people on foot in Times Square, 100% of the space. And so people would trade the safety of the sidewalk for the street. And you know, we're all New Yorkers, and we like to get around in the New York minute, you know, fast. And it drives us crazy when, like, tourists are there, walking along, looking up, it's taking forever. So we would jump into the street, right, to get by, and we get hit by cars, and it's not a happy scene. And, you know, because we are really crazy about getting around. But I remember when my first year of being commissioner, there was this art group that came and they went to the Fifth Avenue. And so, you know, the sidewalks are wide on Fifth Avenue, right? Now Fifth Avenue sidewalks are very famous for another reason. But, so, there was this group, and they dressed up in New York City DOT uniforms. Vest, cap, it was very attractive, you know, pants. And they actually took their paint and they painted a lane in the middle of Fifth Avenue on the sidewalk. And on one side, they wrote visitors. And lo and behold, everybody started following, you know? They were following it. And there were people that would like beg to get into the, you know, residence, like, I'm a Bob Walker. No, no room for you. And I actually got letters like for like the next year from everybody saying, like, that was a great idea. So New York is crazy for space. So I brought this idea to Mike Bloomberg to close Broadway cars between 42nd and 47th Street, do it as a pilot program, see if it worked. If it worked, we keep it. If it didn't work, we put it back to the way it was. So it was an election year, so I remember taking this to Mike, and we're in near the whole room, all up there, all the deputy mayors. He asked everybody what their idea, what their thoughts were about this. And again, did I mention it was an election year? So let's just say no, it was not a very popular idea, at least not at the time. And so after going around the room, the mayor turned to me and, you know, with all of this input, and he said, you know, I can ask my commissioners to do the right thing according to the political calendar. I ask my commissioners to do the right thing, period. And he shook my hand and he said, let's do it. And so we did. So we put up those famous orange barrels, and it was great, and we were standing there congratulating ourselves because we were so psyched about what we were about to do. And then we realized that there was nothing there except for asphalt, which was a terrible thing. This was going to be a disaster. Again, it's late at night. And so the idea of putting something there came immediately to the forefront. And so we went to Pinchuk Hardware Store. How many of you have been to Pinchuk Hardware Store? Okay, so you've been, you know, right? So they had a great collection of beach chairs. So we bought all these beach chairs, $10.99 beach chairs, and we brought them back and threw them out there. And it was fantastic because the next day, the only thing people talked about was the beach chairs. They did not talk about the fact that we closed Broadway to cars. They talked about the beach chairs. You like the beach chairs, color of the beach chairs, size of the beach chairs. And so I tell everybody, if you've got a big project, just think beach chairs. That's really what we need to do. And so it worked, and it came out as a home run from a safety perspective, mobility perspective, for business. For New Yorkers who wouldn't have been caught dead in Times Square before, it was a great new living room. And that reconstruction work continues today with permanent seating and digital infrastructure. You've probably been through the construction zone there, but it is really going to be a place that's worthy of its name as the crossroads of the world. And it really, you know, remade the image of New York. And so it had started with just traffic cones and a little imagination. And it's a model that any city can follow. And so, you know, it was a big success, and we measured it because I worked for a data-driven mayor, and as he likes to say, in God we trust, everyone else bring data. And we called the plan Green Light for Midtown. So we measured what the impacts were. What happened to safety? What happened to injuries? And it was a much safer place. Pedestrian injuries went down. And it was a huge economic blockbuster. It became one of the top 10 retail locations on the planet. And we used this new economic analysis on other projects, not just to track what happened curb to curb, but also what happened at the cash register. And we found that on streets where we had protected bike lanes, we saw retail sales increase almost 50%. And we saw similar results with our bus projects and with our bike projects. And these figures turned small business owners, who used to be some of our biggest opponents, into some of our strongest allies. Because we moved from streets that were governed by anecdote to streets that were governed by analysis. Because as you all know, if you ask a cabbie what their opinion is of a new plaza or bike lane or intersection crossing, they're going to say what? It's terrible, right? It's terrible. That's a very polite thing that they would say. So these new data points were critical in getting these kinds of changes done. And of course, economics aside, there's nothing more important than safety. And we committed to cutting traffic fatalities by 50%. And I'm happy to see that the de Blasio administration built on that foundation with Vision Zero, which is critical, eliminating traffic fatalities and injuries on the streets. And we started by collecting data on 7,000 crashes and injuries in New York, and we used those findings to prioritize all of the work that we did. And this kind of data-driven approach now, this Vision Zero approach, is now being adopted by mayors all around the world, all around the country, from LA to Chicago to San Francisco and Seattle. And they are committing to Vision Zero because they understand that with analysis and leadership, these kinds of crashes can be predicted and prevented. And it also demonstrates that great ideas cross borders, and no one has a patent on pavement. And every city is unique, but they don't have to reinvent the wheel. And these kinds of projects and programs and ideas that came from New York are working in lots of cities around the world. And so, shortly after I started at DOT, I had taken a trip to Bogota to see the magic of fast buses, which was like an oxymoron in New York City. And it was a great lesson for us because, as you know, we have like the largest bus fleet in North America. We've got the slowest bus speed. You can walk across town faster. In fact, my traffic engineer used to say the only way to get across town in New York was to be born there. So that was really not the strategy for a world-class city. And so we imported this concept, and again, with dedicated lanes and paying before you get on the bus and giving the traffic signals a priority for the buses, holding the green light for them longer, we made traffic, we made buses move faster and ridership went way up. We also took a trip to Copenhagen. How many of you live in Copenhagen? Oh, wow. Their tourism program's working. So, just like about almost everybody in American traffic management, we'd actually never seen this parking-protected bike lane. And so, we actually, after going there and checking it out, we translated that vision from Copenhagen onto the first protected bike lane in North America here on 9th Avenue. How many of you have ridden that bike lane? Ooh, that makes me happy. That's great. So you see what can happen when parking and people trade places. And we extended this approach all across the city and also dramatically expanded our bike network. This is the bike network in 2007, and this is the bike network in 2013. And I love this because it just looks so easy, right? Just write on a map, no problem, no controversy at all. But we're seeing these protected bike lanes surge across the country since we put the first one in New York City almost now 10 years ago. And it's thanks to word of mouth and guidance from NAPTO, the National Association of City Transportation Officials, which is a collection of the transportation commissioners of all the big cities in the United States who came together to pool their information and data to create new designs that work for cities and not just interstate highways. And this kind of guidance is actually leading to things that would be almost unimaginable before, like in Los Angeles, creating protected bike lanes. You know, and you know a seismic shift is underway when Los Angeles is creating protected bike lanes. And you're seeing that in cities from Seattle to Indianapolis and Atlanta and Chicago. But it's not just about moving bikes. It is also about moving people. And by following their footsteps, you can see the possibilities that are literally hidden in plain sight. So, anybody know what this intersection is?
6 and a half.
Yes, you've been there, you've seen this movie before. So this is, and he can tell you, this is on 51st Street between 6th and 7th, and it connects to 8 other mid-block crossings. And as you know, thousands of people are in Midtown at this time. And like the rest of you, you know, none of us really want to walk to 6th or 7th Avenue. It's a long walk. It's almost like a football field. And so people would cross mid-block, not surprisingly. So we created this new crossing, and we channeled a little Harry Potter, and we called it 6th and Half Avenue. And we looked at following the people and where they wanted to walk and what their footsteps told us. And that outline told us what we needed to do. And this theory applies almost everywhere. You can see this in the trampled grass, which was sending a message about what the neighborhood needed. And by walking, by following where people are walking today, you can literally see the power in the city of tomorrow. And it doesn't just stop with street design. We also did that. We turned the entire community engagement process on its head. Instead of basically what would happen is, you know, I would come up or my team would come up and stand at a podium and present a project. Here's the project. And by the way, this meeting would be happening at 8 p.m. on some far, you know, away transit, non-accessible part of Staten Island where we were soliciting your input. And we'd give a presentation and we'd check the box. And that was it. Public participation done. So we flipped the process around and started by asking communities a question. What's the problem you're trying to solve? Let's start with that as the premise and then work backward. And then we actually asked communities what they wanted to see. So creating things like a plaza program where communities would apply, or communities could apply for lots of different things, but they were the ones that were doing the asking. They were the ones that put together the local businesses, solicited neighborhood support, got the local elected officials on board. And neighborhoods and businesses and communities all came together and they took ownership of the places that would be created. And by following the people and giving them power, you can transform the city. And it applies to everything from sidewalk seating, to bike corrals, to limited edition David Byrne racks. I love those racks. How many of you have seen those bike racks? Yeah, those are great. And we work with local artists to bring new life to old surfaces. From bridges, and you've probably seen some of these light shows, to Jersey barriers. And in a city where this used to pass for public safety, it's really not great for residents and seniors, we created a new bench program, and we asked people to recommend where we should put them. And we also started a system of wayfinding maps to make it easier for people to navigate the city. And we did that, we started that because we had done a survey, and we found out that at any point in time, 10% of New Yorkers are lost. And those are the ones that would admit it. So, clearly, we had some work to do. Which leads me to my next point. The public domain is the public's domain, and they will do, as you know, anything they can to defend it, prove it, to put it back to the way that it was. And in a city that's looking to do big things, there's always going to be a kind of tension, a kind of push-pull community relationship. But building those community relationships is as important as anything you put down in concrete, asphalt, and steel. And we did this kind of outreach on virtually all of our projects, bike projects, bus projects, you know, very much engaged in all of that. And the advocates play a crucial role in this. And there is a growing coalition of New Yorkers that are passionate about their streets and fighting to take them back. And I can't say enough about their work. To leaders like Eric McClure, to Paul Steely White, to Clarence Eckerson, who documented it all, and leaders in the city council like Brad Lander. And organizations like Families for Safe Streets, who channeled their own experience and their own horrible loss into action, pushing through a change and lowering the city's citywide speed limit. But it was not always easy. There were bumps in the road. This is infamous Prospect Park West in Brooklyn. Anybody heard of that? Bike lane? Yeah? So the community asked us to fix it about 5 times and turn what had been a dangerous speedway with too many cyclists that were on the sidewalk into a protected bike lane. So we did that. We put in this fantastically protected bike lane. Speeding went down 75%. Nobody riding on the sidewalk. Cycling tripled. All good, right? Totally great. Not so much. As I learned early on, when you push the status quo pushes back hard. And these are protesters who actually came out to object to the lane, saying somehow that the slower speeds made the street less safe. And one local paper called it the most contested slab of concrete outside the Gaza Strip. Right? And you can see what they found so threatening. I mean, who would want to live next to a scene like this? So we were sued, took 6 years of testimony and depositions and on them, and it just ended, I'm happy to say. Yes! And it is proof that you can sue, you can say the sky is falling, you can object to it, but you can't keep a proof like laying down. And bike lash is not just a New York phenomenon, and you've known the symptoms when you see headlines like these. And it's funny because a surreal part of the bike lash is having to defend actions that make your streets safer rather than leaving them in their dangerous status quo state. But you need to stand your ground and make policy not based on the press. And so when we launched City Bike, we knew this is a massive program, 6,000 bikes. We knew that there would be, it would be popular, but we also knew that it would be criticized along the way. And a local magazine, New York Magazine, elicited why City Bike elicited such strong reactions. The New Yorkers didn't like anything healthy, environmental, anything that involved sharing, or was vaguely French. And the tipping point in this backlash came from a Wall Street Journal video rant against bikes. Yeah, you guys know this is going. Where this woman said that she represented the majority of New Yorkers that were opposed to bikes and that they begrimed the city, which we actually had to look up. And she also called out the advocates, saying they were part of this all-powerful bike lobby that was working hand-in-hand with the totalitarian mayor. Wow. So we actually got a pin that said, like, all-powerful bike lobby, because we thought that was too vulnerable. And, but my hero, John Stewart, told it like it was. And I think the backlash is a sign that you are doing something right. It is what happens when you challenge the status quo and you move to a new road order. And today, a typical rider looks like the guy on the right rather than the guy on the left, the Mad Max messenger. And it is a major step because bikes have become just a regular part of getting around. Getting married, we didn't even stage that. And it's really popular. People are way ahead of politicians and the press when it comes to their streets. And the last poll, taken at the end of the Bloomberg administration, we saw 73% support for bike share, 72% support for plazas, 64% support for bike lanes. If this had been an election, it would have been a landslide. And we saw just how much it changed about a year and a half ago, when the administration thought about taking the plazas out to deal with the costume characters who were soliciting tips, you know, Hello Kitty and the rest, Minnie Mouse. And so they talked about tearing the plazas out. And let's just say it did not go over very well. And once the idea was floated, New Yorkers came out in droves to defend Times Square and the other plazas that had been created. And when you think about it, 6 years ago, so many people had opposed taking the cars out of Times Square, and 6 years later, they were fighting to keep them out. It is a new status quo. And it isn't easy creating space for people and changing the status quo. It is a fight. It is a street fight. But it is a fight that we must win, and it is a fight that we can win. And now, more than ever, it is important. Because when you change the street, you change the world. Thank you. Now you all know why I love this one. I just want to make one little observation that's larger than the specific issue, and then get to some of the specifics. I think it's really important for everybody to understand that what Janette has described is really a metaphor for how communities and cities are reborn everywhere. That in all the successes that she's seen, that I've seen, it's all these little interventions, the small interventions that start
and build and win favor and spread versus the big top-down projects that take years, cost millions, and are usually objected to by local people. This is real bottom-up. This is real Jacobs. And what I love about this success story is that it does show the larger value of this approach to urban change. So I want to start with one question, a couple of questions, and then open to the audience. I have to say, I have friends who keep blaming me for all of your good work and say, oh, you changed the city and I can't get around anymore. I try to say some of your data about Times Square. When you actually study the difference in the traffic time and the traffic pattern, you alluded to it, but what was the difference? Was there really an increase in the traffic flow, and if so, where did the other cars go?
Yeah, it is this notion that if you close, you know, that any space you take away from cars will create Carmageddon. You know, it's just like this principle, 101. Everybody knows that. And yet, 50 years of transportation planning has shown that, you know, when you build another lane for cars, they would use it, and you basically will be in the exact same situation, if not worse, than before. People thought that when we closed 42nd Street and to 47th Street on Broadway, that it would be Carmageddon. Same thing. Cars wouldn't know where to go. It would be, you know, this huge traffic problem. And it wasn't. And drivers knew how to get around, and it was not an issue at all. In fact, the traffic moved 4% better than it had before, because you're balancing the street. You're making the network work better, right? And so when you recognize all the players in the network, you can actually improve the efficiency of that network. Now, I remember when I was talking to Mike Bloomberg about this, and I told him how we were going to measure the data. You know, we were going to, in fact, there's a strategy called the floating car technique, those transportation walls in the room, where you drive a car through a project area before, and then you simulate the after, and you, so the traffic, so that we measure the time that it would take to go through on the before, and then the time that it would take to do the after. And he was very skeptical. He was like, how do I know, Janette, that your cars are not just going to drive fast, you know, in the second version when it's done, and then you're going to show that it moves better, which was a good point. And so, not that I would ever do that, but we had just actually implemented putting GPS devices, global positioning system devices, in all 13,000 million cabs. So what we were actually able to do was measure the data that we took from 1.1 million taxicab records to measure what actually happened on the travel times. And we found that the travel times moved, the traffic moved 4% better than it had before, and much better on the avenues. And in fact, when you're talking to your friends who say, you've screwed up the entire city of New York, Roberta. How could you possibly have done that? What you can tell them is that no, in fact, the data that was taken shows that at the end of the administration, with all of the changes that we put in, bike lanes and plazas and bus lanes, traffic moved 4% better, actually, overall, than it had before. Because again, it is about balancing a network and bringing more efficiency out of the streets that you have.
This is really an interesting phenomenon because it goes back, in fact, to the Jane Jacobs story of the closing of Washington Square. And at the time when Moses wanted to bring the traffic through Washington Square and speed it down, Fifth Avenue, you know, would go down, be extended through the park. And when the community started by two mothers, Jane joined later, were resisting, and Moses was yelling, oh, you're going to come back to me and beg me to do it. And of course, they asked for an experiment. That's the other thing about a test. That's always the way to get something started is a test. Tests wind up being permanent. So, something miraculous happened. They closed the park, and the traffic did not increase. And it disappeared. And one of the things that Jane had said, and I think it's still true, she said transportation engineers are so focused in a one-direction thinking that they never ask the question of where did the cars go? And it's a real mystery because what she's describing happens everywhere. And traffic disappears. We know it moves elsewhere and whatever, but the few studies that have been made years ago show that traffic gets bad enough, some people stay home or find other ways not to have to travel or whatever. But it's a question that no one ever really tackles because it seems so counterintuitive. Where does the traffic go? Anyway, how about some questions from the audience?
First of all, I want to commend your efforts with the bike lanes, not only as somebody that uses it on a daily commute, but also for recreation. It's definitely a system that works, at least when cop cars aren't paused with their flashes. But a lot of the change that you've enacted is on a very physical or human-driven level. I'm curious if you're now thinking about what you could do with emerging technologies or like mobile integration or planning ahead for like automated buses or self-driving vehicles, stuff that is coming down the pipeline but not really there yet, but will continue to drastically change the fabric and the nature of cities moving forward into the future.
It's a great question. And there's no doubt in my mind that we're on the cusp of a massive revolution in transportation. And the very changes that we just talked about, to some extent, are a little bit at risk if we're not careful and thoughtful about how we plan our cities. So we have started to do some work. The National Association of City Transportation Officials, NACTO, which admittedly sounds like some kind of UN peacekeeping force coming on the ground, you know, like, ooh, the NACTO troops are here. But I encourage you to check it out. Has a great policy and a set of principles that were worked on to give some guidance to cities that are looking at how they're going to adapt to this new technology to ensure that the technology works for cities and not the other way around. Because it should be about just getting as many cars as possible through the system so that everybody can get their car in 30 seconds. And what does that mean for curb space? What does that mean for crossings? What does that mean? There's so many implications for this technology. And it's hopeful, it's optimistic. There's a ton of things that are going to improve safety, being a basic one, like repurposed asphalt for affordable housing, green infrastructure, and the rest. You know, it's very, very exciting. But we have to be very careful about the principles that we use to wrap that and framework that we set in place to make sure that we just don't continue to make the mistakes that we're just escaping from, you know, from 50 years ago with the car-oriented design principle. And so that work is very much underway, and it is incredibly important. So there's some very good cities that are moving forward on this. Los Angeles has a great new smart mobility strategy that I encourage you to check out. It's on the LA DOT website. And it's probably the most forward-thinking policy document that's out there, looking at it from a variety of perspectives. But there's no doubt that a lot of work needs to happen, and even some of the baseline assumptions that we've had about future year projects and demand will change with this. So it's going to have profound implications all across not only the industry itself, but in lots of different arenas.
I can project anyway.
No, you need the mic.
Roberta first, here and then.
Okay.
All right, Roberta said experiment and Janette said pilot. The current administration is going kind of Moses full steam on the streetcar. So my question is, how would you have done more of a chain approach to create create something like the streetcar, which will increase mobility, but which doesn't have a pilot or experiment?
Yeah, so I really do not comment on current projects underway, and I haven't since I left. I will say that I think it's really important. There are lots of steps along the way, and I'm a big believer in bus rapid transit, and I think there's a lot of efficiency that you can bring to the network right away that I would look to. And you can almost outline that system on a BRT basis, you know, to sort of see how the corridors would work. I think it's really, really important that the transportation investments that are made connect as deeply as possible to the existing transit network. And without that, I think it's not a good use of money. And I think also it's incredibly important that it's on dedicated right-of-way. Otherwise, you're going to repeat the mistakes that we've seen in cities, you know, across the country. So, you know, you can stripe it out, and I think it'd be very interesting for you to lead the charge from getting that. Where are you from?
I won't say who I work for that's involved in transit.
So I think you and your transit friends together on that. But, you know, and there's really some exciting precedents that are happening. I'm really excited about what the 14th Street with the People Way can do, right? And I think that's a really interesting model to look to in terms of revitalizing other corridors.
I'd like to add a little something to that. I think part, I agree with everything that Janette said, because there are a lot of different steps of things that can do if the goal is really to improve the transit and the movement of people. I think the real problem with the proposal as it now stands is the objections, as I'm hearing it, is where it is being located, and that it might be a stalking horse for big new development. And this is more the issue rather than, I don't think the opposition is to improved transit connections, certainly between Brooklyn and Long Island City, a major need, but it's more locational than I think than anything else. Okay.
Hi, thank you. You know, between New York and United States, I go back and forth to India, and your work is extremely inspiring. I served as a planning commissioner for City of Newark, New Jersey. I'm also in India, Bloomberg and Modi has a consortium for 100 smart cities. I'm advisor to two of those. I take my bicycle everywhere. If I go to Washington, D.C. or to Boston, I take my bicycle in the bus. My question is very, it's about the contra bike lanes. When you go opposite the traffic, you know, as a bicyclist, you have one-to-one contact, eye contact, and then you can avoid a lot of accidents which we list in Vision Zero. And one of, in terms of climate change, you know, what happens is when you're in the same bike lane, you're right behind the exhaust of the cars, and you directly inhale all the dust and smoke, as compared to like if you're traveling opposite. You know, why I'm asking this, because I think this is easy to do. It's a street fight every time somebody is opening, you know, somebody's path and open or they swear. So we never know, like, you know, somebody is behind you and there's an accident. We were able to do this very easily because, you know, we don't have any laws or precedents. So when we were designing bridges, you know, we have an infrastructure practice. So when we are designing flyover bridges, we actually very intrinsically do that. We actually call it an urban surgery. But you know, the bicycle lanes and like this counter bike lanes, we were able to do this intrinsically. there was no questions asked, and, you know, in many ways we were able to accomplish that. What it will take, what kind of fight, what kind of, you know, programming it will take to experiment or even to sort of implement something like, something very useful like this.
Are you talking about what it would take to do that in India, or are you talking about what would it take to do here?
For example...
No, make it quick, make it a direct question, please.
Yeah, see, what happens is, like, when we go with the traffic...
Oh, you're talking about contra flow of bike lanes versus regular bike lanes? I think, you know, it's really hard to generalize, because I think you really need to tailor designs to meet the needs of the local street and the local network. So I wouldn't want to say, just generally speaking, in terms of how that goes, we tend to go with traffic. We're usually dealing with a transportation network that we need to make work. So the streets have been done that way, and we find it a little more dangerous when people have to look, you know, to look at several threads of traffic to go through. So, but it really does depend.
Studies or any pilot or anything else or any other examples?
I would check out the, I keep doing this, but go to the NACDO website, and there is also a bike way design guide that I encourage you to check out.
I checked that, and actually the website...
We need to take other questions, please. There's a gentleman back there who's been waiting.
Roberta, Janette, thank you so much for your time. You talk about assumptions and small interventions. I noticed in the book, Janette, you mentioned the 12-foot lane and kind of rethinking the width of that. What are the key assumptions are you rethinking now into the future with New York City and other cities? Because I know you're consulting for other cities now as well. And I think, Roberta, you had the same impression for you. Like, what assumptions are you rethinking about the city these days?
I'm looking at what is the framework that works for cities. You know, and in a lot of instances, you have great technology coming in that allows Uber and Lyft and Get and lots of, you know, terrific companies, but we have to make sure that it's working for people and for cities. And so we're not only looking at the dimension of our streets, but we're looking at the application of this technology to our streets, which means we have to look at where the demand is. And that means we need to have origin and destination information, and that means we actually have to have access to the information that these services are providing, which we're not getting. So coming up with a new framework, almost a, you know, new sort of rights of the city in terms of this new mobility, this new shared mobility, is going to be very, very important moving forward. So that's one of the areas that we're focused on right now.
And I would add to that there's plenty more work to do with the approaches that have already been successful. I actually fear the falling in love with the smart city concept. In the end, it's still about people, it's still about gathering places. And I remember observing, and actually had a conversation, this was years ago, with Jane about this. And she said that, I don't know, they always talk about the technology is going to make cities, obsolete. Well, because people will be able to do their work anywhere. She said, but the Great Plains are still empty. My observation was that the first thing that happened after the computer and the internet was the internet cafe. People need people. And that's at the crux of cities. So when we start getting all excited about all these new technologies, I think we have to just keep focus on what, who, and how, and what to keep the essential elements that are proving so successful not to interfere with. Over here.
Thank you, first of all, for your work over the last 15, 20 years, whatever, in making the city a much more livable place and making things work a lot more efficiently for people who live here. One of the projects that didn't gain success was the pushback. congestion pricing in the central core. Do you envision any time when that might again resurge and gain acceptance, or is that something that's high on the screen?
You know, I do think it's a matter of, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. The politics don't look like they're aligning anytime soon. But I just think it's a matter of time. I mean, we need actually to price our system, right? And we really need to take these revenues and use them to rebuild our transit system. And we still have a huge deficit in what we need to build on the transit side. And transit is the lifeblood of cities, and particularly this city. I mean, it's astonishing to me that we are just now finishing the Second Avenue subway. Astonishing to me, right? And that's what made this city great, you know, since 1904. And so it is my hope that we move forward with some version of that. I thought Sam Schwartz's Move New York proposal was a great new iteration. Because when you think about it, and I think this is an error on our part, when you put it together, like congestion and pricing, two things that people hate, right? Wow, what great branding, what genius came up with that, right? Whereas Move New York, well, that sounds like something you want. So I think that looking at different ways, whether it's cutting the price of bridges in communities that don't have access to transit as part of that package, looking at different ways to put it together, I do think that there is going to be an iteration that needs to happen, because we don't see a lot of money coming from the federal government. We know where we are with the state government and similarly on the local side. So we're going to need to be much more creative about how we actually use and price the system.
As a point of history, for those of you who are not old enough to remember, or if you've read The Power Broker, the Second Avenue subway was Moses' promise to New York for taking down two L's, the L trains. And because he was so anti-transit and pro-car, he starved the transit system, took out the streetcars that we had all over, but the L's were going to be replaced by the Second Avenue subway. So someday that will happen, but it was supposed to happen when he said it would. That was one project he didn't want to do quickly on time.
Over here.
I'll just ask this. Thank you. A little bit of a two-part question, but I'm wondering, across the city, in your work, the community engagement side really appealed to me. So I was wondering, what are some of the needs that were different across different neighborhoods across the city, maybe given people's demographics in a certain neighborhood? And then what are some ways that cities can make these kind of changes more equitable, so it's not just in the most touristy parts of the city?
No, that's a great question. And New York, you know, it's such a diverse place, right? You know, you think about where we are right now, downtown Manhattan, and then you think about, like, you know, Stapleton or any place on Staten Island, you know, very different communities. And in fact, when I talk in different cities, there was this image that New York City is like Midtown, you know? Like, you couldn't possibly understand what we mean about big roads. Like, have you been to Staten Island before? So you have to definitely tailor the projects to meet the specific needs and the demands of local communities. And it was interesting because one of the big things that we did on the public space investment side was to create a program that communities could apply to that I talked to you about. Mike Bloomberg was very adamant that when we did public space, we couldn't create public space without creating a maintenance program that went along with it. Because in the 1980s, there was a lot of public space that was created, and they turned into garbage pits and really horrible spots that nobody wanted to go to. And so that was great, but there were many parts of New York City where there's not the financial wherewithal to create a business improvement district that would take care of the space, right? And our public space strategy couldn't be, oh, we're going to do public space only in wealthy neighborhoods, right? So we ended up coming up with a neighborhood plaza partnership program where we basically, we got some grants, and basically what we do is we do that early maintenance and create a system where, and this is a pretty unusual partnership, where we took people that had been in Rikers Island, former prisoners and people that were formerly homeless, you know, through ACE, and actually created a system where they went to the greening. People coming out of Rikers were trained in horticulture, and they would then maintain all of these different, you know, green spaces in these new plazas, and formerly homeless people would take care of the maintenance of the space. And so it was kind of a holistic approach to it, and we did that all over the city so that it, we made sure that it wasn't just to depend on whether you had the wherewithal to create a different kind of a plaza, but you know, we could provide that infrastructure to allow these other communities to, you know, come on board and get trained and become a part of the process. That's one small example that happens all over the place. With the Select Bus service line, I think that creating access, you know, getting transit into underserved areas is critical. And again, it doesn't take a lot of time, it doesn't take a lot of money. You know, it's not like having a whole subway system built. So moving quickly on that. And I think that your point about, you know, what about the equity lens is really, really important. And, you know, we're doing some work now with Bloomberg Associates in Oakland, which is dealing with a lot of those kinds of issues, and their entire strategic plan is done through an equity lens. So it's a very interesting change, and where are you paving? Where are you doing potholes? Where are you putting these projects? What is the prioritization? So I think you're seeing cities all around the country now sort of have kind of an aha moment about how transportation can be such a driver in terms of providing much more equity to neighborhoods, and I think that a big part of that is also that transit connection and making it possible for people to get from point A to B, to get to jobs, to get to school, to get to church, to get to wherever they need to get to, and not have it cost a lot of money. And so I do have a transit background, so I do think transit is the secret sauce for cities, but providing as much of it as you can, wherever you can, I think is really important. And I think it's really exciting to see cities around the country really embrace and move in that direction.
Question? Hello, thank you for all the work you've done. I'm a public
health researcher. A little louder.
I'm a public health researcher, and I appreciate everything you've done to make the city more mobile and the equity concerns, I think, are first and foremost with most projects. But as Citibike has approached a phase three expansion, for the first time, Citibike will be going to some neighborhoods that are maybe less transit connected, but also have more pronounced chronic disease burdens. And as we're thinking about what city subsidy should be for possible phase three expansion, or thinking about affordability, in New York or elsewhere, I'm just curious if you've worked with people who make a public health you know, policy argument for providing bicycles for everyone to use from a health perspective.
You know, I think that that is a less recognized aspect of what a strong biking network and bike share network can do. I mean, you've seen some cities that highlight that, but not nearly enough. And when you think about the crisis of obesity and diabetes and everything that we've got, I think that, you know, doctors should be writing prescriptions for city biking. So can you get that done? Because that's really what we need to see done. Yeah. So I think it's the tip of the iceberg, but I think we'll see more of that.
Right here. Here you go.
Just anecdotally, in my neighborhood, three of my friends have been hit by bikes. Can you tell me, do you have data on whether bike lanes have improved or decreased pedestrian safety with bikes? And yeah. is there any education for either pedestrians and bike riders how to negotiate the bike lanes? Because people are sort of, they don't look. The bike lane is not, you know, you step into the street, your eye is on the traffic, it's not on the bike lane, and they come down the hill, and so I'm just wondering, do you have data on bike accidents and normalized or the increased bike traffic?
Yes, we do. In fact, I'm happy to share that data with you, but generally speaking, if you want a safer city, build a bike lane. Because what we've seen with all of the data is that when you put down particularly protected bike lanes, it is safer for everyone. It is safer for pedestrians, it's safer for cyclists, it's safer for drivers. And bike lanes, period, make a street safer. And it's kind of common sense when you think about it, in that what a lane does and what cyclists do is it naturally slows traffic down, because drivers are looking at, there's lots of different kind of activity in the street now, whereas in the past what you've seen is wide streets that almost look like they're invitations to speed. They're almost like jetways. And so cars go really, really fast because they expect that that's what the street is for. It's for the car. And when you start designing in people and other modes of transport, suddenly people are looking out for one another and respond differently. And so even though it can feel like, oh my God, look at these cyclists, they're crazy, it really depends. It's kind of like how you get around depends on how you feel. So when you're a pedestrian and you see the cyclist going by, you're like, are you crazy? You just almost hit me. I almost got killed because I didn't even see you and you came out of nowhere.
And you're going through a red line.
And you're going through a red line or whatever. And then when you're a driver, you know, it's the cyclist or it's the pedestrian. Would you pick your head up out of your piece of glass? You know, I mean, there's that. And when you're a cyclist, you're like, you feel like, you know, they're all out to get you, you know? And so it's this kind of match. And I think part of it is it's a culture change. It doesn't happen overnight. You know, looking out, looking both ways, looking out for one another. It takes a while. And in fact, when we first started putting out a bike lane, I had this extremely subtle program that was designed just for New Yorkers. And you know what the name of the campaign was? It was a safety cycling campaign. It was called Don't Be a Jerk. So we need to continually educate, and we need to, you know, and it takes a little while to get used to, but the data is there. I'm happy to share it with you. But it is frustrating. We all have to, you know, they need to follow the rules of the road as well. And so it's a bit of a tumble, not quite at that tipping point.
And there are as many bad bikers as there are bad drivers. And I experience it every day crossing, going into the park with my dog, with bikers going through a red light or coming down a bike lane the wrong way, so there's no reason for me to have been watching. But you're talking about the bikers, not the bike. And the culture, I think that's right.
Hi. I was wondering if you could talk about women and dogs active commuting, and just if, I know that there's been studies like...
Say that again.
I wanted to know a little bit more about your perspective on women and this whole active commuting movement, because I've seen studies like the Rubin Center for Shared Transportation saying that like 25% of city bike rides are women in 2015. I don't know what it is now, but like, I just... compared to like therefore 3/4 are taken by men according to that study. So I'm just curious, like if, and I know I read your book that there's obviously this is changing and more women are active commuting, whether it be biking or more active and bringing their kids out. But yeah, I'm just wondering if there's any cultures where, I know that there's a New York Magazine article that said that in a lot of the European cultures that have strong bike commuting, that the numbers are more equal among men and women. And I'm just wondering if there's anything, any advocacy movements you see or any initiatives that have really been able to change, like make an American city or a city that wasn't, where it was very imbalanced with men and women being active commuting.
Yeah, I get your question.
Yeah.
It's really about the design of the street more than anything else. And, you know, there is this, not only the safety in numbers phenomenon, the more people out there, the safer the street is, but I also look at women and children as a kind of indicator species for the safety of the network, much like scientists look at whatever efficient a stream is to a stream's health. And so that idea that when we've got more women and children out there, they're out there when they've got a safe network. When they don't feel safe, they're not out there. And so it's really incumbent on cities to put out as safe a network as possible. And the cities that are cited, you know, northern European cities mostly, have strong developed networks. And that's really what it takes.
We'll take one more question right here.
Hi, I volunteer in women's bike advocacy, that lady, to walk riding with a woman. I had a question about, I think the bike lanes are great, but one thing that I haven't seen yet, which I know happens in Europe, is sort of prioritizing the timing of street lights and prioritizing lights for bicycles, because I think the reason that a lot of cyclists, including myself, sometimes run red lights is because lights are timed for cars, so we're just going to continuously hit red lights over and over, and it feels like the system isn't designed for us, and we're sort of making our way through it, like a bike lane.
Yeah. Right, and there are some cities that have made some big progress on that. I mean, Portland, not surprisingly, has got some, you know, signal progressions that are there, and other cities are testing it out. And so, I think that would be a good suggestion.
She's not in charge here. With that, I'd like to thank Janette.